Good afternoon, folks. From here in Delhi, Center for Health and Social Justice, I'd like to welcome you on to our first webinar for our course on understanding masculinities. And it's great to be able to interact with all of you and also receive some questions from some of you based on what you have been going through in the first two modules of our course. What we'll do today is I have a brief presentation which deals with the crucial ideas that we have discussed in the module with some, of course, with some additions. And I'll then discuss some of the questions that we have received. We will also give you an opportunity to send us some of your questions. You can use the chat box to send us questions on issues that maybe coming up during the presentation or something that you have from before. The first question that comes to us is why are we talking about men? You know, all this while when we were talking about gender, the conversation was primarily about women. But here, why are we talking about men? You know, the problems that we know face, women have to face them, the issue of gender-based violence, sexual violence, issues of poor development indicators around health, education, and all kinds of various social issues, like issues that are coming up, like declining sex ratio, early marriage. And in such a situation, why is it necessary to talk about men? It's not that men have not been discussed in the context of development, but we must be very clear what our perspective is. Oftentimes, we think that, you know, it's easy to talk to men. It would be easier to talk to men and get them to endorse the ideas that we would like to get through. Since men are in positions of power, they're the leaders in the community. Is that why we want to talk to them? Is it because when we are talking about violence against women, the perpetrators are men? So, of course, we have to talk to the perpetrators. So men need to be addressed from that perspective. Then there is a group of which is concerned about men's needs. You know, there's a conversation that when we talk about health, it's mostly maternal health, it's family planning, it's reproductive health. What about the problems that men face? Is it because of that that we need to talk about men? Why is it that we need to discuss men is a big question. Now, when we talk about this particular course was designed not from any of these three points that I mentioned, but what we have designed this course from the perspective is that we need to understand patriarchy, we need to understand masculinities, because these create certain conditions or compulsions or kinds of situations which compel men to behave, act, think in particular ways. And those particular ways, which are part of the social script, need to be changed if we need social relationships, if we need gender relationships to change, if we need women's practical status to improve. This is the perspective from which this course has been designed. Now, to say that this is the first time that we are talking about men in a gendered category, no. Men have often, or if not, men have always been seen as a gendered category, and I want to show you how men have been seen as a gendered category even in the earlier things. Like this course, you've seen that earlier, men were considered part and parcel of the hard development approach in which men's gendered roles were seen as important and women were considered invisible. Then we had the issue of women's development, which came up as an issue of concern, and those were social issues, issues like literacy, issues like a little bit of income generation. And these have changed over time. You have read about the WCAG gap that has been discussed. And finally, the issue of gender and women's differential or special needs was discussed in the mid-90s when we had ICPD and we had Beijing conferences. But soon afterwards, what we see is that violence against women and HIV/AIDS became important issues of concern. And when violence against women and HIV/AIDS became important issues of concern, the implication that these issues had in terms of men's involvement came fair and square on the development arena. And since 2000 or so, the issue of working with men has slowly gained some popularity in the development arena. As I was saying earlier, men have been considered as a gendered category even before. What we see in family planning programs have been among the first programs that have seen men as a gendered category. Initially, what we saw is that in various countries, including in countries of Western Europe, in North America, what was happening is that sterilization was being done on poor and often poor colored men because there was this issue of racial superiority, and poor black, poor colored men were supposed to be inferior. So within eugenic programs, there was a clear focus on men. Thousands and tens of thousands of men, black men, were sterilized in North America. Sterilization of Roma or Gypsy men took place in Sweden till the early 70s. Then we see family planning again in India between the 1950s to the late 1970s. We saw targeting of men as irresponsible breeders because vasectomy camps were primarily targeted at men during the 70s. Then in the 80s, we saw HIV/AIDS being associated with men, but not men of all types, particularly gay men. So the entire issue of gay men, their sexuality, their multi-partner sex became an issue of great concern. Moving to the 90s, it was seen that HIV/AIDS spreads through all forms of sexual relationships. And what was seen then was that men became the vectors, or men became the kind of carriers of the disease. So men were always kind of seen as, there's a victim-blaming kind of approach in the gendered work that has happened over time. However, at the same time, there has been some work around reproductive health, especially in maternal health, when men were seen as batterers and batter interventions took place, and then, in the maternal health program, they were being seen as gatekeepers. So talk to men, get their permission, and then your intervention with maternal health will be more, implemented more effectively. So that has been the way, either as gatekeepers in the recent past or in late earlier, men being seen as irresponsible breeders or as violent. That's been the way men have been addressed as a gender category in development. But we want to review that. What we want to do is understand men and masculinities through a lens which enables to understand why do men behave the way they do. And for this, as you will see in your course, we have addressed issues of patriarchy and construction of masculinity and how they influence the overall gender equality that we see in society. You have discussed the issue of gender identity, you've discussed the issue of gender roles, you've seen how that creates gender division of labor, and then we have differential access to spaces, we have different access to opportunities, and finally, all this ends up creating a particular power relationship in society where men are consistently in positions of privilege. However, at the same time, what is happening is a process of socialization which is forcing, or which creates certain compulsions for men. Men become comfortable, become used to their position of power and privilege, to the fact that the family is going to follow. Mothers are always telling their sons on how lovely they are, how they are the apple of their eyes, how they must always be performing. But at the same time, what happens is that men, certain things get restricted. It's not that it's full freedom. Many of you must know that if a boy says, I want to learn music, it is not something that the family is immediately very excited about. However, girls, especially in our South Asian context, are often sent to music classes to learn music or to learn dancing, but the same opportunities do not exist for boys. Boys are supposed to go into science, boys are supposed to go into finance, boys are supposed to plan for good jobs. Whereas these differences are not for the same girls in the same family. So these create a particular kind of social script which boys are supposed to follow. However, even though this is a compulsion for boys, they end up with a lot of social privilege, end up with a lot of economic privilege, end up with the corruption. Now, times of cultural, social prerogative that has gone on for generations creates a kind of social aspiration is the idea which is bred into men. They must always be in a position of superiority. They must always be dominating others. They must always be in a position of control. Even those who, because of various other reasons, because of issues of poverty, because of social position, may not be in a position to dominate others, but their aspiration becomes one of domination. This aspiration itself is what creates the mentality or the mindset of hegemonic masculinity. Now, what I want to summarize is how do these interact with each other, these various social forces, to create social norms and expectations. So what you see is, on one side, we have gender roles, relationships, and creating different access to access over and control over resources and social expectations. These together create the social norms. Now, these are then fulfilled by a particular kind of masculinity or a particular kind of social expectation of men. However, at the same time, this interacts with the particular situation the person is. So masculinity is not an absolute kind of feature. A question that somebody has asked is that, can there be diverse masculinity? It is always diverse. That is why we say that masculinity is not the term, but it is masculinities. Because what the idea of being man is different based on what your social class is, what your religion is, what your ethnicity is, what kind of history you're coming from, etc., etc. Now, this is then endorsed by society. That's very, very important. Society creates a compulsion through either endorsing it, or if you want to deviate, it gives social sanctions. It tends to stigmatize the person who wants to behave differently. And together with these expectations and the social sort of endorsement and sanctions, a particular culture of masculinity gets bred in society. And what does that create? It creates different kinds of social hierarchies. And within men, what we have to realize is that while patriarchy is creating hierarchy between men and women, there are different hierarchies within men itself. The broad category of men are also divided based on caste, class, nationalisms, sub-nationalism in South Asia, particularly in India, what your linguistic differences are. Even if you go to countries like Pakistan or in Bangladesh, the issue of language becomes extremely important, and the major language and their minor languages and their social positions are different. Of course, the issue of history, the issue of sexual identity, the issue of hierarchies within men. And for us to understand the hierarchies that exist within the social class of what is man is extremely important, because it affects the way they see themselves and how they relate with others, relate with women, relate with other men, and what kind of social sort of circumstances, which we do not like, get created. Now I want to come to some characteristics of gender relations in South Asia. Now, somebody here, I received a question of whether social and homosexual are related to each other and whether they form a continuum. What I'd like to focus on first is the fact that we have to see that in South Asia, sexes are usually segregated, and there is high levels of homosociality, meaning same-sex groups. Now, the question is this related, or does this create homosexuality? I do not know. The question is, what we need to realize, that any particular person's identity is not fixed. It is not fixed over time. And what the current understanding is, that these are fluid identities, these are fluid situations. And whatever it is at one point, we need to respect it. So if it is a question of respect, if it is an issue of choice, and if it is an issue of fluidity to make decisions on whether one will convert to the other, whether there is a question of there is a sort of degree of what I would say is compulsion, that is not important. Whatever it is needs to be respected. However, in South Asia, we do have various traditions which are interesting in the sense that in South Asia, homosexuality, or the historically we know the criminalization of homosexuality, recent phenomenon, it's in the last 150 years. It is a result very clearly of British rule over South Asia. So historically, we have found that there has been a level of fluidity which has been accepted in the South Asian tradition. There have been various South Asian traditions of comradeship. There have been various South Asian relationships of same-sex relationship between male of the guru and the shishya. Whether there is a sexual dimension in that relationship, we do not know, and we are not willing to speculate at this point in time. However, same-sex social relationships have been extremely prevalent. The other thing in South Asia is that there are a range of cultural practices which are discriminatory and violent towards women. Now, since the middle of the 19th century, again, we started having attention drawn towards practices of infanticide, to practices like sati, which existed over all of British India, and the first issues of widow remarriage. So those practices were culturally ingrained in South Asia, and over time, the understanding of women's rights as it has increased, we have realized that these are not only discriminatory, these are unfair towards women. At the same time, we also know the strong issue of honor. In South Asia, honor killing is more or less something which is unique to South Asia, and this honor oftentimes is the family honor, but it is embodied in the women's body. And when there is a fight between groups, the person who stands to suffer is the woman. In Western India, we still have situations when there is marriage across caste lines, the family of the bride is targeted for violence. So we have to understand that this unique notion of honor has tremendous consequences in terms of what it means to be a woman. But the idea of honor is something that men are concerned about. Their honor is lost. Honor is not lost by women. Men lose the honor and women receive the violence. So this is extremely unique to South Asia. The other thing in South Asia, which is more or less across different countries, is the compulsory heteronormativity. Even though same-sex social relations have been there across time, people within mainstream society are expected to marry. You're growing old, immediately your family is interested in your marriage. The issue of marriage is still a family issue. It is not something which is a matter of choice. In many cases in India, we particularly see if you marry out of your religion, out of your caste, you can become somebody who's outcast from your own family, your family disowns you. So there are these strong heteronormative compulsions in India, and I'm sure in probably other countries of South Asia, because this is an issue of cultural similarity. And once you are married, you are expected to stay married for a long time. The issue of women leaving marriage is not common. However, a man taking a second wife is not so common. So women get trapped in the marriage, even though the marriage could be one of violence. So these are some characteristics of gender relations, which are issues of great concern. And one of the reasons why, especially Center for Health and Social Justice, got involved in work with men was to address the social compulsions that women have to face. And through that work, we slowly got to know more about masculinity. And as we have worked over the last 15 to 20 years, our understanding of what it means to work with masculinity, what it means to work towards gender equality, has increased. At the same time, like, we need to understand men and masculinities in the context of women and their lives, we also need to understand how masculinities and male sexuality affects men. Now, many of you must be familiar with religious codes. No matter what the religion in South Asia, and we have our main religions, Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, we find that the idea of ideal behaviors, which is often called Dhamma or Dharma, both in Buddhism and Hinduism, or sometimes called Usul and duties in terms of Islam, four stages of Hinduism, these are certain expectations which have been coded into into certain religious duties or stages or commandments, and most men tend to follow them. However, at the same time, especially from the Hindu point of view, what we see is that there are multiple models of masculinity. That we have the violent warrior kind of masculinity, but we also have the servant, tenant, supplicant kind of masculinity, the priest kind of masculinity. So it's not that all men are forced or expected to behave very similarly. So there are certain issues of similarity, but there are certain issues of difference that we find in South Asia. Then we find certain relationships between men, which are codified, the son and father relationship, the friendship or yari dosti relationship, the feudal and the, or the landowner and the servant or the tiller or the person who works on your land. So that's a subordinate relationship. These are also relationships which are socially coded and people have to follow accordingly. The idea that in many parts of South Asia, especially within the Hindu and Buddhist religious sort of tradition, the idea of celibacy, the fact that the more ideal or the more ideal man you become, you actually become celibate. You don't have relationships with women. Now, this is an issue that needs to be considered, whether it is a misogynistic or are you frightened of women's sexuality, we do not know. But there is certainly this as a model that is there in South Asia. The fact that in South Asia, there is huge issues of semen loss. Research across the countries has shown that this is a common phenomenon. Men are extremely concerned about maintaining their vitality, their physical strength, and semen loss or sex is often seen as a weakening issue. Similarly, there is this fear of what the research has called the non-contact problems, not sexually transmitted diseases, but diseases like situations like whether your penis, what is the shape of your penis, what is the size of your penis, whether you have nightfall or wet dreams. So these have a whole range of concerns for men. So these are concerns that men have about their own sexuality and how their masculinity gets unconsciously structured. So what do we have as a result of the gendered relationships? What do we have as a result of the masculinities in terms of what we see as real life problems in South Asia? The issue of declining sex ratio is a common issue across South Asian states, and this is directly related to the gendered nature of South Asian relationships. The fact that there is consistent higher mortality, morbidity, lesser education, especially for women. The fact that women's mobility, women's access to and control over resources, this is also a consequence of the kind of social construction of masculinity that I mentioned. The issue of dowry, the issue of violence that children have to face as a form of disciplining, as a way of toughening. And overall, if you look at our region, we have very little concern about women's reproductive health among men. So these are issues that are very clearly a result of the way social relationships, gender relationships are structured and the way masculinity is constructed in South Asia. So obviously, our concern, and here I want to talk a little bit about the work and that we do, and which has been the basis behind this course, is our interest in gender equity and social justice. And we believe that in order to achieve gender equity and social justice, it is important to understand masculinities. And hopefully, the subsequent two modules that we have will enable us to understand how there are solutions built into our work with men, solutions built in from our work with men, which are applicable to our work around violence against women, to our work around sexual and reproductive health. So that's the broad perspective from which we approach. I don't want to talk too much about this anymore because we have two more modules in which we will be discussing the more practical aspects of this work, and I'll stop here. If any of you have questions, please send a message through the chat. Welcome back. Thank you for your questions, and thank you those of you who sent questions earlier. I'm glad that there are certain questions, and I'll broadly talk about certain conceptual issues, then I'll talk about certain history issues, and then a certain issues of practice and how do we move ahead. First, I'd like to talk about the issue of intersectionality. Now, intersectionality, the term actually comes from feminist studies. Very clearly, it applies to women and their position in society as well. So the idea of feminist, from feminist scholarship where intersectionality was drawn was from the US, when in the women's movement there was a discussion whether the experience of being a woman was the same even if you were somebody who is colored or somebody who is white. And from that understanding, it was understood that, of course, when you are a colored or a black woman, and whether when you are not a woman who is a white woman, there is the issue of race and racial discrimination, which intersects with the fact that you are a woman. So from that understanding, slowly the understanding of intersectionality has increased. Now, when you see intersectionality in the context of work with men, what is important to consider is that when you have multiple social axes that I was discussing earlier, you see that there are certain social axes in which you are privileged. As a man, you have privilege. And there are certain social axes in which you have discrimination or you are in a subordinate position. If we believe in equality, now this is extremely important. All our analysis is predicated on our interest in equality. So if you are interested in equality, then intersectionality allows us to have a theoretical framework to understand how to deal with power. Now, if you are in a position of privilege, then you have to realize that power has to be equalized, because somebody gains power and keeps on gaining power, then somebody else will have to lose power. At the same time, you know that when you are talking of multiple social axes, you can gain power on one and you can become equal on the other. Suppose you are man, meaning you have privilege on the gender axis, but you are in a subordinate position in the social caste or social class axis. How will you behave with community outside? How will you behave with family at home? When you're in a position of power, you use that power to control people at home because you are the man. But when you are outside, because you are a socially subordinate, you feel extremely hurt because other people talk down to you. You don't like the fact that other people talk down to you. Then you have to become sensitive to the fact that your behavior of being in privilege does not become disrespectful of others in the family. That means you start valuing respect. You start valuing the idea that all human beings have to be respected. The fact that all human beings have to be respected is the core belief on which human rights and gender equality is based upon. So I think this is how intersectionality works. It's extremely important in understanding men and also moving us slowly into practical directions of how you work with men, which was a question that I received. Now, there is another question which says, if there are multiple social identities, or let us say multiple social axes on which we create our identity, which is the most important identity? I think this most important identity changes according to the context. When we are within our family, our being a man or being a woman becomes important. When we are in an office, our position of the post that we hold, that becomes important. When we are in a community peer group, there another thing becomes important. The point to realize here is there are certain social forces in South Asia which are trying to push men and push communities to make one identity their sole identity. This is identity politics. We have to be extremely cautious about it, because the moment you privilege one identity over everything else, your self-respect depends upon that identity. Everything depends upon that identity. You forget that you are something else in other cases, and people compel you to support, or your solidarities are based on that identity, and your enmities are also based on those identities. So for my understanding of equality, social justice, human rights, we have to be cautious that one identity does not become the most important identity. The moment one identity becomes the most important identity, people who don't have that identity become subordinate, you start looking down upon it, you start feeling threatened, etc., etc. So that's my personal view on identity. Then there was a question on hegemonic masculinity and whether it changes according to context. Now, first and foremost, I'd like to say is that hegemonic masculinity is not something which is a behavior. It is an aspired behavior. So it is an aspiration. Even when I'm in a subordinate position, I might be the most youngest, most junior, most subordinate person in the office, but I always want to be the boss. So the wanting to be the boss is the idea of hegemonic masculinity. So since I want to be the boss, whenever I get an opportunity, I behave like a boss. And what does behave like a boss mean? Control others, to put other people in their place. Now, this is the aspect of hegemonic masculinity that we want to reconstruct, because hegemonic masculinity necessarily requires vertical social relationships in which one is superior and the other is subordinate. If we are going to talk about equality, then hegemonic masculinity has no place. We have to create a situation where people are valued, respected, wherever they are. And the value of and respect for equality means to also understand people who are in positions of privilege and power, they need to learn to share their privilege and power so that others who don't have privilege and power are able to gain privilege and power. Many of you must have heard about the power over, power with, and power to framing. Hegemonic masculinity depends on a power over framework. We want to change it to a gender equality, social justice framing, which is a power with, which is a solidarity framing, and power to, which is an empowerment framing. So that is the way we would like to reconstruct hegemonic masculinity. Does it depend on context? Absolutely. You cannot exercise hegemonic masculinity in all places, because of your other social identities, you will not get the space to exercise hegemonic masculinity. But you will always want to. Whenever you get the opportunity, you try to behave like a hegemon. Let me now come to a question that we received about, is there any history about pre-colonial relationships? Yes, there is an excellent book. It's called History of it's Writings on Same-Sex Relationships in India, and the author are Ruth Vanita and Salim Kidwai. What we will do is we will send you the proper reference. We will send it to all of you by email. So there is a history, you can read it. There are lots of historical texts which talk about same-sex relationships. The issue of vocabulary, now this is a tricky question. The what has happened is that in most cases, sexual vocabulary has been converted by, and that's the way sort of society tries to also control, has been converted into slang, obscenity, or into abuse. So whenever you want to discuss sexuality, it appears that you are being abusive. Now, that is the way in which society has tried to sanitize itself. We have to be cautious that we do not fall into the trap. Now, unfortunately, what we do is we try to use more, formal language, which is often either English. So we will discuss sexuality in English. And when you talk sexuality in English, many people in our region don't even understand what you're talking about. So one needs to generate a respectful vocabulary. It is an issue of concern, but we need to generate a respectful vocabulary in which the negative value of stigma, the negative value of abuse is removed. Another question that we received is around if some boys and men work towards gender equality, some of their power, how would such people buy in for projects which work with men? Now, as I told you, the intersectionality approach allows you to work on more than, or consider more than one social axis at the same time. What we have found in our work, and this is work which we in India as well as colleagues in South Asia, it will apply to, is that oftentimes because we are a very homosocial society, because there is sexual segregation, the relationship between husband and wife, or relationship between brother and sister, or the relationship between father and daughter is often slightly constrained, slightly distant. What we have found in our work consistently is that when men get involved in work around gender equality, what they say they have gained is in their emotional relationship with close family members. That has been something which they have consistently, and this has happened in extremely patriarchal regions in Maharashtra, in Uttar Pradesh, in Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan. There is a sense of now, a much greater sense of solidarity, both at the emotional level and at the practical level. So when you say, what is the buy-in? There is a huge buy-in because they gain. Relationships between husband and wife have improved. Now, when relationship between husband and wife have improved, actually it also to some extent improves sexual relationships. So from violent relationships, you can have better sex relationships. So that is a kind of improvement that we have seen in South Asia. Now, can this be generalized? I don't have enough information to generalize this, but this is something that we have consistently seen, this better relationship, which is a powerful buy-in for men. The second buy-in that we have seen, which is extremely important as well, is that these are men who do not fall into the, let us say, mainstream masculinity model. So today, they are slightly uncomfortable in society because they are not so hegemonic to start with. But when they start working with themselves, they become sort of seen as role models for other men. Their social prestige, men's social prestige increases because across society, we have found there are many, many men who do not like to be in this constant competition, hegemonic, dog-eat-dog kind of situation. So when you have an alternative model in which you can be more considerate, more compassionate, you can talk to your friend without discussing a competitive issue, without going and beating somebody up, that kind of space is something that other men are also seeking for. So men who start this work become a new kind of leaders in their society. And that leadership, that social prestige is an external value that they have seen. What we have also seen is that when men start creating new partnerships, either in their own family or outside, those partnerships can lead to more creative expression, including business. Men and women in the family, we have seen, have now doing their family business better. Friends who come out together are doing social projects together more creatively. So if you look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you can start fulfilling your fifth level of self-actualization, which is a strong later, not immediately, but later becomes a strong attraction to continue this work. So these are some of the answers that I have from my experience of doing this work. If we have 5 more minutes, so if there are any more questions, please quickly There are a couple of more questions. Are all masculinities negative? I would like to know about masculinities in Africa, and there are some hegemonic femininity. Now, first let me take the question that I don't know. I do not know the issue of Africa. Now, I have been talking to friends who work in Africa, and I've been encouraging them to look at more social, sociology, anthropology kind of information. The unfortunate part is much of the work on masculinity comes from the health field. So sometimes we are using demographic means to understand masculinity. I personally don't think they are very useful to see all men as same. There are certain issues of there are certain common issues. The issue of patriarchy and subordination is extremely gendered. Subordination is a common principle. But the way intersectionality works differently in different places. So if you ask me if the same patterns are there in Africa, I am sure the same patterns are there in Africa. But whether they manifest themselves in the same way, I do not know. What I would encourage colleagues who are joining in from any other region in the world, does the idea of multiple social hierarchies, does it resonate with you? Do you see that in the place or work where you work, there are men from different social groupings who have a particular idea about themselves and a particular idea about the other, which is a relationship of subordination? If it is there, then how were they created? But what we also know, and what we have seen very useful in our work, is that there may be a dominant hegemonic model or a dominant hegemonic what you could call people are, that's what's the mainstream. But there are many subaltern masculinities also. When I say subaltern masculinities, what we see in South Asia is that within the broad framework of Hinduism or Islam, there are other relationships which are more equitable. Let us say that the Sufi tradition, let us talk about the Bhakti tradition. These are much more socially egalitarian. Of course, they don't talk human rights the way we talk human rights now, because these are 700, 800, 900 years old. But they are certainly far more egalitarian framework of understanding human relationships. If you look at Amartya Sen and his book, The Argumentative Indian, he has talked of this argumentative tradition or the tradition of heterodoxy, which is strong in South Asia and which allows us a secondary or a subordinate or a subaltern tradition of relationships among men, and which creates opportunities when you are working with men. Now, this is an opportunity, gives you an opportunity to work with men. Now, there's another question here which says that hegemonic femininity, and can we see that reference to hegemonic masculinity? I would not call anything hegemonic masculinity or hegemonic femininity, sorry. The idea of patriarchy and hegemonic masculinity is not something that gets embodied in men alone. Now, this is where I'm talking of the idea is not only embodied in men. There can be women in positions of power who replicate or do the same kinds of actions that replicate hegemonic masculinity. Because these are ideologies. These are aspirations. These are not behavior stereotypes. So it can be done by either male or female. Bhakti and Sufi poetry offer an understanding of gender that is quite at odds with hegemonic masculinity. Absolutely true. And what I have seen in our work in Maharashtra is that many of the people who came and joined our work, they actually belonged to a Bhakti tradition. Because the historic tradition was Bhakti, they could easily identify with the tradition of egalitarianism. So it makes sense for us who are working in any area to understand whether there are historical traditions which over time have been wiped away. Some remains may be there in the culture. Here is a question of feminine identity. Absolutely, the points that are being made are absolutely true. They're completely, I agree with you. Identity politics, unfortunately, doesn't engage with spiritual notions. Absolutely. The idea is to understand that identity politics creates divisions.
And our main purpose is to build egalitarian relationships. We are not saying become the same. We are saying keep your distinctness, but respect all diversity. So that's the point from where we sort of approach this entire work. Any last words? Thank you all. I think you had a good engagement over the last 1 hour. If you still have questions, please don't hesitate. Send us your comments, send us your questions, and all the best as you continue this course. We will have a second webinar towards the end of the course. The time will be intimated to you soon. Thank you all very, very much.